Good afternoon. Welcome to Talks at GS. We're honored today to have Josh Sapan, the CEO of AMC Networks. I thought that we might spend a few minutes and just talk about your career. How did this end up being
sure
your industry and where you spend your time?
Great. I'd always wanted to work in television. I'd always wanted to work in either movies or theater, and was a failed actor, writer, and producer. Happily, the failure was so rapid and so complete that there was no ambiguity about whether it would ever work. So it sort of all, for me, I don't know how you guys feel about your careers, but it sort of came together because I thought, oh, gee, it'd be nice to make this material, content and TV shows, and isn't it intriguing because it's going to change radically as a consequence of this technological change when the country is wired. And obviously at that point in time, the country was not wired. So there's actually now a wire, as we all know, that connects almost every household in America. And there are 100 million, as we call them, pay television homes, people paying round numbers for extra channels of television. Cable TV generally is what it's called, subscriptions, which is now under some form of pressure. So that's what caused me to go get into it, if that's an answer to the question.
And if we look right now,
yeah,
binge versus broadcast, how do you address that in your business?
It's been quite meaningful because we're fundamentally in the television business in a paid
the big screen system.
Well, first of all, big screen, but also paid ecosystem. We're not fundamentally a streaming service.
Right.
We're not first and foremost delivered on the internet. We're first and foremost delivered as channels on your cable system, satellite platform, et cetera. So the way we deal with it, and it's, by the way, we've just hit on a very big issue, of course, which is a true change in the manner in which people are using technology, right? They are using the internet as means of delivery. That's actually quite recent, relatively. We better acknowledge that and do something about it in our composition. And we've done a few things. One is that we, in order to participate in that so-called system or ecosystem, whereas we used to commission TV shows that we didn't own, we set up what's called our own studio, AMC Studios. And this is going to sound like a minor nuance to you, but it's sort of fundamental and important. So what that means is we have today, right now, I think we have 8 or 9 shows in production around the globe. So we have TV shows, sets, and crews all over the place, and we'll probably be doing, in this current year, 12 or 14 scripted dramas that we own. What that means is that after we put them on our channels in the US, or our channels overseas, because we bought a group of overseas channels a few years ago, so we're now in 140 countries outside the US, we can sell those TV shows 2 years later, 4 years later, or any time that we choose to streaming services. Mm-hmm. And so we'll sell to Amazon, Netflix, Hulu, or whomever in the US on a later window, and we sell them to those services around the globe. So we have diversified our business.
Now you have different brands, right? You've got the documentary, you've got the independent film channel, you've got Sundance, you've got AMC, you've got BBC. How do you choose what goes where, and how important is it that AMC shows look and feel like AMC shows relative to Doctor Who on
right.
BBC?
Right, very important. Because we are in the business of brands, and brands are organizing principles that people do rely on, and they do make decisions on them. And there's a whole bunch of data around this. So intuitively, one could say, I just like my TV shows, I don't care where they air. That would be the argument that brands in the television world don't matter so much. But there's a whole bunch of human behavior that suggests that I can take ourselves or I can flatter others, that people actually do know what an AMC show is like, and they have a sense of what to expect. If you say, it's a show on AMC, they don't think, I have no idea what that means. And that can range from Mad Men to Breaking Bad to The Night Manager to The Walking Dead to Fear the Walking Dead to Preacher, and that's a bunch of different material if you're not familiar with all of it. The fun part of it, you asked how you pick and how you assign, and that is the sort of, if you want to call it the fancy word, would be the art of the business. It's not quite art, but it has a lot more to do with judgment than science. And so several years ago, we decided to do a show about a zombie apocalypse, which at the time was actually a fairly radical idea. We had two big shows on AMC. We had Mad Men and Breaking Bad. And if you're familiar with Mad Men, it was a quiet show, and Breaking Bad was also a sort of studied drama. And so doing a show in which zombies were eating people didn't seem to be the necessarily likely thing that we would do, but we actually thought the story was spectacular, the source material that was spectacular. And if there's one thing that we'd like people to think about AMC, it's that it is that the stories are great. Are there any fans in the room of The Walking Dead? Thank goodness. Thank goodness. So this is, I'll just play this little trailer, which is a promo for the upcoming season, if you don't mind.
There are rules. You earn what you take.
You should know. This is the only way.
Things have changed.
Whatever you had going for you, that's over.
Thing is, I am everywhere.
The Walking Dead season premiere, Sunday, October 23rd at 9, only on AMC.
This seems like the best part of the afternoon, isn't it? Watching every time. I always thought if I get to watch television at work, that's pretty good.
All of us probably feel like we individually can predict, you know, the next 12 or 18 months of technology change. You sit in a seat where you at least get to spend some time wondering what's 5 or 10 or 15 years in the future. Any predictions for us of what we should look for, anticipate, dream about?
There are a few things that are resilient. One has been, there's been certain stories, no kidding, that just, they work. Star Trek has worked, Star Wars is a big deal. Mark Twain still tells amazing stories. John Le Carré writes amazing books that have amazing characters. A.A. Milne wrote Winnie the Pooh, it hasn't gone anywhere. And Eeyore still looms large in my mind. And so I would use those just as an illustration of so-called intellectual property or stories that are spectacular. But I do think that people love that stuff, and they love it because it is fundamentally human and it is beautifully done, and stories and character development is just irresistible. It's irresistible. It can reincarnate in different forms. It can be done on big movies, it can be done on small screens, but I would say the safest place to go if you're looking for 15 years is killer writing, killer wonderful source material, killer storytelling, and there'll be many other things that occur. But I do think that those things have, if not an eternal quality, they have a long life. And so being in that business, and then being in the business that distributes that effectively, would probably be the best guiding principle for that long a period of time.
You may have the best job that I've ever been exposed to, and we wish you great luck in keeping it going for the next 10, 15, 20 years.
You're very comfortable. Thank you for your hospitality.
Thanks. Great. Thank you.